And from beautiful, beautiful and colorful Virginia, just hearing a few stories about frost hitting. And you know, when that frost hits, the colors change. And that's my favorite time, no doubt about it. It's a glorious time of year. And you know, I wouldn't opt in for, you know, one season for anything in the world. Been there, done that. I lived in Florida for a number of years. And no, I'll take the seasons out, even though it gets cold, right? You know, you'd have to be in a coma or on the other side of this life to not know that we just come through another major election. You know, in fact, our world seems like a perpetual election anymore. It's driving personally me insane, and it's distracting lots of people from success, to be honest with you. And despite the outcome and the ranting and the raving that led up to it and that still goes on today, people are still ragging on their enemies, right? They seem to have absolutely no self-control over their words or their behavior. And despite the fact that their rantings and ravings can't really change the outcome of the direction of things at all, you know, they just keep going on. When I look at life, when I look at politics, and especially when I look at our business, I'm reminded of how important it is to control our words, to limit them sometimes in order to not just to find peace, but to see success. So the message today was inspired by lots of different things you'll hear about in this call and our reaction to them. And it's entitled, Zip It Up. You know, it takes incredible self-discipline to tame the tongue. Believe me, I know, right? And it's such a challenge because of the power that we have with words. We know that we have that power. And sometimes, you know, when we're passionate about something, it just comes out. Sometimes it requires that we pause and we think before we speak. And sometimes it requires that we just learn to zip it up. You know, it's not easy for most of us, that's for sure, especially when we're passionate about something, you know, like life or this business or, you know, God or family, whatever it is, right? It's not easy when there's passion involved. The Bible is filled with wise words about the tongue and the words we speak. For instance, we hear, with it we bless our Lord and Father, and with it we curse people who are made in the likeness of God. It's not easy when we're passionate about something and we're working against the flow of whatever it is. It's not easy to stop and think, wow, you know, this person's made in the likeness of God too. It's not easy. It's a very difficult thing. Here's another one. If anyone thinks he is religious and does not bridle his tongue, but deceives his heart, this person's religion is worthless. I'll paraphrase that, or, you know, summarize it by saying, if we're walking around saying we're Christians and we can't watch what we say, it's worthless. You know, I don't know about you, but I don't want to die thinking my life was worthless all because of my words. You know, there's plenty of wisdom and instruction to be found in the Bible when it comes to these things. Why? Because our words are a very, very big deal. You know, you'll never read in the Bible or any place else, self-help book, Jim Rohn, Zig Ziglar, doesn't matter. You'll never hear that it's okay to just let somebody have it just to stay on point, you know, or whether you see them changing or not, just stay on it. Or to turn up the heat, sharpen the insults when people aren't believing what you believe. Good luck, you're never going to find it. You know, it doesn't matter if the other person is right or wrong. And it doesn't matter if it's in your home, in your office, in your business, in your party, in your church, you still don't have the right to badger and badger in an attempt to change a mind. And with words we can encourage, or with words we can rip up and destroy. We truly do have power of life or death in the tongue. And when we're in the ripping up mode, we are never justified, no matter the circumstances. There's never justification for it. I grew up with a mom, you guys have heard before, she had a very bad temper, and hurtful words would fly everywhere when she was mad. The damage that was done the second she spoke those words. And unfortunately, when we speak those words, we can never rewind them. We can't take it back, right? I think maybe things might have been different for me had she, you know, gone off the handle, said hurtful things, and then come to me and said, you know, what you did was wrong, but I was also wrong. I don't know if it would have changed it or not. In her eyes, she was always justified. She would say, well, if you hadn't done that, or if you hadn't said that, then I wouldn't have lost my temper. I wouldn't have said those things, you know, like she was justified. You know, I'm grown up now, and unfortunately, I'm growing older by the minute, right? But some of the words still creep into my head every once in a while. Those hurtful things still surface, and I spend more time than you want to know overriding what was said to me, all in the name of being justified, right? She thought she was justified to say or to speak what she did. And we're just never are. You know, so saying whatever's on your mind, no matter how rude, crude, or socially unacceptable it is, just doesn't fly. It doesn't fly in relationships, you know. Just imagine in a relationship, you know, when things are passionate and emotions are involved and it's personal, you know, and you just say hurtful things, they can never be taken back, right? And so we can't just say whatever and say, well, it's true, you do this or whatever, and kind of, you know, handle things the way my mother did. You can't just slap things or people around verbally and then expect it to be okay. We certainly can't do it with our children. You know, we're starting to see, or I just shared with you what it's like for me. You know, you can't speak to them insults and berate them and insult them and then expect to have a well-rounded human being before you later on. You know, you can't do it in the church. You know, if there's anything ugly, or if you've ever been through like a church split where there's division in that church, oh my gosh, I can see why people don't even want to go to church. You know, people backbiting and gossiping and Pharisee-like attitudes, it's horrible. Certainly can't see it in our political world, you know, and we're not going to see it in this business. If we want to have a fulfilling life, then we must at least try to zip it up. You know, the older I get, the more it bothers me when I hear people proclaim that they've earned the right to speak their mind. You know, whether it's the fact that they're a Christian or the fact that they're a senior citizen, as if it's some sort of right they have that we get at the older we get. But hurts, insults, pain, and everything else is never justified just because of our age. As a woman of faith, there are lots of things about this world I'm living in today that bother me, lots and lots. But I have to tell you that politics is the least of them. Because you know what? I know that if we had the moral fiber that I long to see, if we had the Christian faith predominantly, you know, through the land that I long to see, you know, that if I know that it begins with you and me and not who we vote in, right, is a bigger problem. They, you know, these people work for us, they represent us, but you know, the bottom line is they speak for their people. So if you don't like which way the wind blows, in the political world especially, then it's time to understand that it's the people behind the ones that you don't agree with that drive the train, and you'll never reach them with insults. That's just common sense. And not just common sense, it's a spiritual truth. We're ambassadors for this company, and we say what we say in public absolutely matters. You know, we have to zip it up sometimes about medical claims and financial claims to protect the foundation of our company. You know, what you say could ultimately hurt me and my business, right? And yet some people just cannot exercise self-discipline, self-control to resist saying those things that should never be said. You know, some of us are ambassadors for Christ, and every single word that we speak counts, and we're told how to speak and how to behave and how to love our quote-unquote enemies. But it's funny when you think about it in a weird sort of way. Whether we're talking love, we're talking relationships, religion, politics, or this business, our words are key and should be our biggest priority, to choose them carefully, to think before we speak. But you know what's even harder than learning to speak good words? It's zipping it up. You know, when it comes to business and or our success in any area of life, sometimes the problem isn't that you don't say the right thing, which is what so many people sit back and do nothing about because they're worried about, will I say the right thing? You know, will I say it in the right way? The very things they worry about are not the biggest thing they have to worry about. Sometimes the biggest problem is that we need to learn to say nothing at all at just the right moment in time. I was coaching somebody recently, and if she's on the phone, she knows that I forewarned her I might do this, and I love her. This is not criticism. It's a teachable moment. But this person, incredibly knowledgeable about, you know, our product, that she's a very knowledgeable about chemistry. She does an amazing job explaining things. She's got a great personality. She's very likable, right? But not everybody wants to hear all that she has to share. She just thinks they do. And so, you know, the same is true for you and me. Sometimes we just need to learn to zip it up, to ask questions and listen to the responses, and to refrain from sharing ionized water 101 with everybody. In this particular case, she had the attention of someone within the first few minutes of talking to him. She was actually at work and she had an opportunity to share. And this person almost immediately said, you know what? I believe you. I want one. And they asked, well, you know, how much does this thing cost? And she explained, you know, what she thought would be best for them. And they're like, what are you, hey, wow, I thought it'd be like $10,000. I want one. And even though that buyer was ready to buy, she couldn't shut up. She just kept going. She kept going right past him saying, I want one. She just kept pouring water on him despite the fact that he was already sold. It's been a week since he said, I believe you, I want one. And I've had to coach her through the process every step of the way, every word to say. More importantly, I had to coach her in with love, by the way, through how to learn to just zip it up. You know, she's supposed to get his order in today if she continues to be teachable and she follows what works best, right? For instance, he wants to place the order. I just, you know, that's where he is, right? And she just wants to go to his house and do a demo. And so I'm like, why would you want to go to his house and do a demo? He's already sold. You know, he's ready to place it online. She wants to go visit and do the paperwork, you know, hard copy. Then why, she's in the way of herself, right? Believe it or not, this is a problem not of self-discipline, that's for sure. But it's also a sign of self-sabotage. She's been doing and saying everything she can not to make that sale. And when we get to the bottom of it through coaching, and believe me, we will, I think we'll find that somewhere inside of her, she just doesn't believe that she can succeed. Furthermore, we're probably going to find that she believes that she can't succeed because of words that have been spoken to her, whether it was long ago as a child, through a bad marriage, whatever it was, we will get to the bottom of it. So we'll be working on words and affirmations to try to rewire her brain the same way I have to try to rewire mine. And we'll be working on coaching her to zip it up. This is the biggest problem I see as I help so many people on our journey. It's not what they say. It's not what you say, guys. And you know, it's not even how you say it. It's so that people need to learn to zip it up and listen instead of overloading with knowledge. I helped another situation last week, and the two people in our business, wonderful people, both of them, both professed Christians, just love both of these people, but they had a transaction together that went south, and one that could so easily have been amicably resolved. But now, you know what? It probably isn't going to get resolved. All because one side believed they were justified to spit out insults, to spit out threats, or whatever they had to do to make their point on the other. There was room for improvement, frankly, on both sides. And with just a little bit of help, both sides could have seen the other person's point. But those harsh words and threats killed the deal. And it really doesn't matter how justified the one feels. They need to take responsibility for not ever getting to resolution, all because of the word they spoke. So on the other hand, if you remember nothing else today, remember this. There are plenty of people in this world that will never buy into what you have. You know, they'll never buy into your faith. They won't buy into how you vote. They won't buy into the product you have. And absolutely nothing you say is going to change their mind. Even Christ told his disciples that if people, I'm paraphrasing obviously, but if people in town don't listen to you, just kick the dust off, keep moving. He didn't say settle in, pull up a chair, berate them and stay there and keep talking until you convince them. He didn't say that. He said, keep moving. Because, you know, guys, we don't understand it, but some people are going to get it and some people aren't. And you're not going to change those ones that aren't. There are plenty of people that need to hear what you have to share. And talking until you turn blue with the ones that refuse to believe what you believe will never change the outcome. It's sad to say, but when I sit on the sidelines coaching people who are having difficulty moving forward, they need a little push, right? I can honestly say that beyond making that effort in the first place, of course, the biggest challenge people have is self-discipline, learning to zip it up, to listen more than they speak, to stop making assumptions about other people, to just ask the leading questions and to do whatever you can to answer whatever you can, right? But when you ask the right questions, then you need to learn to zip it up. Because when you can exercise that self-discipline and you get off your high horse in life, you can learn everything you want to know by asking just a few questions with the right heart and then zip it up and wait to hear the answer. This is true in your relationships. This is true with your children. It's true with your church, your faith, walking out your faith. And it's certainly true in this business. It's not easy because we're humans filled with emotions, but it is possible to learn to exercise self-discipline. When it comes to the words you use, the way you say them, and sometimes more importantly, learning to zip it up. You know, life isn't easy sometimes, and we all have so much to learn. It never ends, right? We'll never quit learning as long as we want to learn, and we have so much to accomplish, and that doesn't end until we do, hopefully, and we have so much growing to do, and that is a daily effort. You know, there's never enough room to emphasize that enough, you know, that we need to work on the growing every day, but it's a whole lot easier when we take responsibility for ourselves, when we practice self-discipline. when we walk our faith, you know, the way we're instructed to do, especially when we encounter people that don't believe what we believe, whether it's our, you know, in our faith, again, it's in our political stand, it's in this business, it doesn't matter. That's when especially we need to be walking that walk and talking the talk with compassion. No amount of pouring water on somebody will make them buy into our company if they aren't inclined to join, no matter what you do. No amount of berating or insulting or digging, you know, throwing trash at the competitors, no amount of any of it is going to change a mind or heart of a loved one or one of your enemies, none of it. And the sweetest responses, those responses that lead us to solutions, usually come after we've zifted up. One of my favorite hymns of all times is In the Garden. And part of the lyrics say, he speaks and the sound of his voice is so sweet that the birds hush their singing. Now, let me tell you, that's sweet talk, right? The God of the universe, you know, he can be a God of wrath anytime he feels like it. He can shake the mountains. He can bring the rains and cause the floods. He could berate us every day of our lives because, frankly, we deserve it. He's a jealous God, and anybody could be justified to say whatever he wants. It's him. But when he speaks, sound of his voice is so sweet, the birds hush their singing. I know one thing. When I leave this earth, I want to be known for my love, for my heart. I want to be known for having an unshakable faith. It's non-negotiable. You all know that, right? I want to be known for unconditional love and not as being the one that stood up and spit out insults on a street corner like a crazy person, you know, trying to get people to believe what I believe, you know? God can take care of that all by himself. So how about you? Are you talking and talking and turning till you turn blue, trying to get people to buy into your business or to your beliefs? I sure hope not. And I hope that you'll find see how fruitless that really is. You know, the other day I posted a comment on Facebook and it said, I wish I had a dollar for every time I was accused of being a doormat or weak because I extended kindness in the face of meanness. But wussies can't do that. It takes character and strength to pull that off. And I hope you agree with that. We all need to work on our words. We all struggle and will always struggle with the tongue for as long as we live, unless we pull it out, right? Who wants to do that? Exercising self-discipline is key. So I hope that you'll remember it's always garbage in, garbage out. You can't process positive, beautiful, loving things as long as you're feeding stuff with other things, right? And if you want to grow in this area of your business and for your life, dwell on the positive and not the negative. Watch your words. Learn to zip it up. For your business, you know, you'll learn to see amazing results when you do. You know, when you just learn to listen a whole lot more than you speak. And you just accept the fact that not everybody going to buy in to what you believe. So in this world, we have to be a good example. In our business, we have to be a good example. And the way that we do that is, you know, through compassion. So on that note, guys, I'm going to leave you with that and hope that you'll ponder it. Seriously ponder it. You know, we all have strong beliefs and strong opinions, and God knows everybody on this call, I would think, is very passionate about our product, about, you know, good health, about our company, and about the opportunity. We're very passionate about it. But it's accepting the fact that we need to exercise a little self-discipline, and we need to accept the fact that not everybody going to believe what we believe. So on that note, you guys go make it a great day. I'll see you at the top, and I'll see you next week. Take care. Bye-bye.